For fans of the RB26 and the 2JZ, there are arguments that have raged for years about which model's superior. And when it comes to the import drag racing scene, the 2JZ seems to have a distinct advantage with a number of teams already in the 5-second bracket. We're here with Dom from Tony Rigoli Performance, who's trying to show that the RB26 is still a stout competitor. So let's get into this. The RB26, you're no stranger to that particular engine, and particularly in the streetcar world, we see some pretty stout examples of both. For a start, can you tell us why you think the 2JZ has kind of made its way into the 5-second bracket so quickly?
Yeah, well, I guess in America, they've been running them for a long time, and there's been a lot of development, whereas, you know, it's kind of the other way around in Australia. Guys, a lot more RBs that people are playing with. So yeah, they are years and years ahead of us in that respect.
In terms of the engines themselves, the RB26 obviously in stock form a 2.6 litre with twin turbos, not that that's meaningful when you start modifying them. The 2JZ in stock form has a capacity advantage with 3 litres, but yeah, again, when we start modifying these engines, really there are no sort of rules or limits. So can you give us a rundown in your own personal sort of experience where the pros and cons of maybe each lie?
Yeah, well, I mean, you've got to bring the capacity up on the RB26 to kind of make it comparable. I think boost for boost, you know, a 2J to an RB, I don't believe there'd be a lot of difference. But then again, I could be wrong. A lot of the guys are pushing, you know, the limits, pushing big boost, massive turbos to get into that 5-second zone, and we're sort of still heading that way. You know,
if we back things back to sort of a more street level, I've got probably more experience with modified RBs than 2Js, but from my own angle, and this could be somewhat controversial, I see that maybe the RB26 in stock form is a little bit more fragile. There's certainly a few parts that are key that need to be changed if you want to build a reliable RB26. Do you think that's fair to say?
Yeah, that's correct. You know, the blocks aren't they're not strong. You know, they crack, so that's why you sort of go to the different block. We still run the Nissan block, but you know, we run the RD, which is a diesel block, and it makes it a lot stronger. That's where we're getting this sort of extra power from.
Now, we want to get into this engine in a bit, but one of the sort of elephant in the room, if you like, has been that over the last few years, we've seen more and more teams go the billet route in terms of the engine block, and certainly that seems to have been one of the things that's made it so much easier for teams to make power reliably. You've just mentioned you are still on the cast iron, albeit the RD block. So where are the limits in terms of power, in your opinion, on that RD block? At what point do you need to step to a billet block?
Yeah, we actually haven't found the limit yet. So that's where we're sort of venturing now. Yeah. So, you know, we're already up to like 2,150 horsepower on that cast engine. Once we do a turbo change, we want to try beat about the 2,300, 2,400. And that's when we're going to find out, you know, how much more that block's got left in it.
So whereabouts are you now in terms of capacity with this engine?
It's 3.2 litre.
Is that about as far as you can realistically push it?
You can get a 3.4 kit for them, but you know, you're sort of overstroking it a bit. I sort of personally like the 3.2.
And in terms of the engine internals to make it reliable, that sort of power level, can you give us a bit of rundown on what you've got there?
Yeah, well, we run the spool crank, and then I run my own piston and conrod combination. And that's, you know, they're not shelf parts. Yep. We've developed them over the last few years.
The bottom end of the engine really, though, is there to just support the power realistically. It's the cylinder head and the turbocharger that really seem to be the key to getting the performance out of these engines, regardless what engine you're talking about. Can you give us a bit of a rundown on the cylinder head package on the engine?
Yeah, well, we run a ram cylinder head, so it's CNC ported, and then I run my own custom grind camshaft in it. You know, all the valvetrain Supertech. That's basically it. So it's still pretty basic, but probably the most you can do to it without going to some crazy port design.
And you mentioned 2,100 horsepower. I assume that's at the wheels or at the hubs?
At the hub, yeah, 2,140.
And what sort of boost pressure are you using to get that?
78 pound.
So at that sort of power level, what's the sort of maintenance schedule on the engine? In terms of how long do parts last at that sort of power level, and what parts are needing to be replaced to keep everything reliable?
Yeah, well, when this car's still too new, so we're still ironing out bugs, but when we used to run this combination in the 300ZX, like every third meeting, we'd just drop the pen, just have a quick look. If it needs bearings, we'll put them in. but sort of just stay on top of that, you know. The rest of it's been pretty good. The block, we done two full seasons with it before we replaced it. So
when you're up at that sort of power level, that's actually pretty impressive reliability. Now, you just mentioned the 300Z, so this chassis is new for you, this combination, but the engine itself has been run in a 300Z. Can you just talk to us about the differences between the 300Z chassis and what you've got now with this 350Z?
Yeah, the 300ZX was like an Australian built car, and it was only a 3/4 chassis, steel body. So yeah, it does.
So for those who aren't familiar with that term 3/4 chassis, can you give us a bit of an idea of what that is relative to a full tube chassis?
Yeah, it's got all the bar work, but in the front area of the car for the class, it leaves all the factory chassis rails in the front and firewall and stuff like that. Whereas a full chassis like this car, it doesn't have any of that. You're not starting with a car, like it's made up.
So is the main advantage there weight, with the full chassis car being lighter, or are there other advantages around the freedom of design of a full chassis car?
That's what it is, the design, the bar work, the wheelbase. And then, you know, comparing that car to this car's American built, and they do build much better chassis than we do in Australia.
They've been doing it for a while now.
Yeah, that's correct.
All right, the 300Z, what sort of ETs and mile an hour were you running in that?
We finished up with a 660 at 220 mile.
It's not shabby for a 3/4 chassis car. Where do you sort of see this going? Obviously, it's relatively early days with the 350Z. Is a 5-second pass possible with the RB engine in it?
Yeah, our goal is to try run a 5, whether we're going to get there with it or not. But I do want to try do it on the cast engine, you know. I believe that a 2J's done it in a cast. So, now, we can go straight to the billet, but there's no challenge there for me to do that.
I know a lot of people, rightly or wrongly, will argue, once you go to a billet engine, is it really an RB or a 2J or whatever it happens to be? So there's definitely a badge of honour if you can do it with the cast engine. Now, you mentioned you're at 2100 horsepower at the hubs right now. To step up, I mean, obviously it's not just a case of winding more power in. There's a lot more to it to get down to a 5-second pass. But what sort of power level do you anticipate you'd need to be at in order to get a 5-second pass?
Well, this car here, like last meeting we were out in it, it was on about 1800 horsepower. It wasn't a clean run, and it did a 662 at 213. Like now it's on 2140 horsepower. If we can optimalize that, there's no reason why it can't run a 6263 the way it is. And then that's when I think we're going to start looking for more power. So we're not really going to start looking for more power until we're sort of in the vicinity of that, you know.
Once you've sort of got some consistency around that 6.2, 6.3 area. And I think it's probably also reasonable to mention for our viewers that while it might sound when you're only 2 to 3 tenths away from a 5-second, well, you're pretty close, so it must be easy, but there's a world of difference between a 6.20, 6.30 and then a 5-second pass.
Yeah. Well, I think it's going to be easier for us to make the power than to apply it to the track and actually tie it all in.
Now, I just want to talk about the rest of the car, because you've just mentioned making the power is one thing, getting it to the track is a completely different deal. Starting with the drivetrain with the car, so what are you running in terms of a clutch and a gearbox for this?
So I run the Liberty 5-speed, and I used to run, it was like an east-west clutch.
So this is a proper drag racing slider-style clutch?
Yeah, like an adjustable. Now we've gone to the EZ clutch with the air-shifted Liberty, so that's all new to us again.
So again, for those who aren't familiar, the air-shifted Liberty is what's referred to as a clutchless box, so it's actually seamless. There's no need for a torque reduction for the gear shifts?
Yeah, no, there's none. And, you know, now we're on a paddle shift, so, like, the shifts will be sharper, you know? Like, my arm's getting a bit old.
Is there an advantage in terms of ETs with the paddle shift versus actually pulling a lever, or is this just a case of being able to keep both hands on the wheel for better driver control?
Well, you're not controlling it. The car drives itself, so it's more consistency. And you know, I guess if you're a little bit more fit, then you can be on point, you know.
Now, getting one of these cars to perform properly with an adjustable drag racing clutch, like you've just mentioned, is really a lot of it is the clutch, getting the clutch set up for the track and adjusting it between each pass. So how much of a challenge is that? Have you got a guy whose specific job is setting up that clutch?
Yeah, well, one of my crew guys, you know, we're both learning together as we go. Yeah. So he'll get in there and adjust it. You're basically just adjusting it to bring it back to where you were to do your next pass, and then we sort of discuss what changes do we need to make.
So you're adjusting that clutch as well based on the track conditions as the track changes during the day?
Yeah, but it's more like maintaining what you've got. So because it's a slighter clutch and it wears, you always need to bring it back to where it was, and then you make the adjustment. So a lot of the times, like in the old car, we had a setting that was, you know, we did very rarely played with, you know. But you are always chasing that perfect clutch setting.
We haven't talked about the electronics package in the car. So what have you actually got controlling the engine and your data analysis, etc.?
Yeah, everything's controlled through an EMtron KV16. Okay. And then we'll just run two M&W CDI boxes.
So that's a CDI, that's ignition capacitive discharge ignition?
That's correct, yeah.
And what are you using for a driver display? Is there anything in there?
It has the EMtron dash as well.
And you're using the EMtron as a central logging hub for all of your data?
Yeah, it runs everything. It's doing basically everything. Just one unit we plug into it.
Perfect. Look, been great to get some insight into the car there, Dom. Obviously still fairly early on. Hopefully we get a good weekend this weekend and look forward to seeing you push a little bit closer to those 620s, 630s. If people want to find out more about TRP, where can they go to?
They can go to trpracing.com.
Perfect.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.